Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Buddham Dhammam Sangham Namassami. So good evening, everybody. this evening the Dhamma talk will be in English, so and as was mentioned, there's no real topic. Sometimes you go to a place and they ask you, well, what title for the talk that you're going to give? And for us who trained under Ajahn Chah, usually, you know, it isn't really how we do things. Ajahn Chah would always say, well, just really quiet your mind, pay attention to the audience and see what comes out. So the idea of preparing a Dhamma talk ahead of time and getting all my notes straight so that I can come up with something coherent and somehow consistent. It isn't quite how we do it. But that being said, just before the talk, I was meeting with the organizers, and I was asking, what might be useful to talk about? There was a bit of a discussion around just like translation of Dhamma terms, and especially when tonight in particular, there are Westerners, and the talk is in English. There's Thai people who are comfortable in English. There'll be Thai people who will be okay in English, but trying to keep up with it, so it's a varied audience, and language. Language is important. It's how we communicate as human beings, and of course, the. Where we are, this is the Buddhadāsa Indapañño archive, BIA, and one of the projects that Ajahn Buddhadāsa had over his whole life was trying to communicate, and he did a lot of play, especially in the Thai language, really playing with the language, trying to introduce Dhamma principles in a way that is understandable, makes sense. Because sometimes, things get put into a scripture, put into a book, put into the popular culture, especially a religious culture, and it gets locked in place. And you can't change it because it's a religious text or it's a religious topic. And then you spend generations of time just boring people to death. It's just, and you know, it becomes, you know, kind of meaningless. So language is a dynamic thing always. I mean, and it is interesting, like the scriptural language, the Pali language, is a, it's not a living language. It's kind of like Latin, so it's a, I mean, it's a dead language. But in the sense that it's kind of fixed in place from scriptures and commentaries, and then locked away like that. Of course, it's a, when the Buddha was living, then he also was playing with language to try to convey meanings that he wanted to, because his insight was new and fresh, and it was meaningful to him, and then how to transmit that so that people can understand it, or how to transmit it in a way that it would kind of make people sit up and listen, because it's so different. So that even the Buddha was using language in different ways. I mean, just like, you know, something that is a very ordinary Dhamma concept, say like the word khanda, speaking of the five khandas, it's sort of the five constituents of being, form or body, feeling, perception, mental formations, consciousness, rupa, vedana, sanya, sankhara, vijnana, the five khandas. And but what it means is just heaps, piles, these five piles of experience, so these five heaps or groups of experience. Because, you know, the reality is that when you speak of the aspects of body and mind, yes, you have five different names for them, but that doesn't mean that they're completely separate, or they don't inform each other, or they don't, like there's a discourse where the Buddha is speaking about this, these khandhas, these constituents of being, and you say, they are conjoined, they are not disjoined. You know, they work together, they fit together, they work together, they bleed into each other. They're not completely separate. You can't have a pure experience of body. Why? Because the only way you can experience body is through your actual mind. I mean, it's just, on a certain level, it's kind of duh. But sometimes language locks us into separation. We get a concept, we get an idea, we fix it, and then we hang on to it. And it's got to be like that, or is in actuality. So that, of course, that's what the Buddha called grasping, clinging, which is another word that the Buddha used in terms of, say, like the word for grasping, clinging, is it upadana. It also is like fuel. It's like fuel. That's what we feed our confusion and our complications with through our upadana, through clinging and grasping. So it's what fuels the processes of complication and adds to our dukkha. So that and again, the word dukkha. You think dukkha is oftentimes translated as suffering, and you think, And that's just so it has so many nuances that it's actually difficult to translate. Just the word dukkha has say the connotations of unsatisfactoriness, dissatisfaction, discontent, dis-ease, in the sense of it's just not easeful, it's not comfortable, it's not pleasant. Or stress, and that's a good word on an emotional level. What the kind of what dukkha is pointing to is we have some kind of stress. It's stressful, so that and experience can be like that for us. Our living in the world, we experience this kind of dis-ease, discomfort, discontent, and that's what the Buddha's point, dukkha. But of course, the teaching of the Buddha is one that is pointing to freedom from dukkha. And that's what he said. And he says over and over again, I teach only two things, dukkha and the cessation of dukkha, the ending of dukkha. And it's important to recognize that there's both of them. It's not just so everything's miserable, so get used to it. There is this experience of discontent or dis-ease, stress, suffering sometimes. And there is a path that leads to the end of that. There is a way to live our life and cultivate that allows us to experience a total freedom from dis-ease, discontent, total freedom from stress. And of course that's that's a very attractive possibility. So that word dukkha, they like in the Thai language, they just don't bother to translate it. And that's kind of helpful because it has so many nuances. But the roots of the word dukkha, I'd say, like, because the Buddha is using it in his, like, it was a word that was used in the Buddha's time, but then the Buddha used it with his own connotations, applying it to his own usage. And it meant, something uncomfortable, in the same way that, say, that the prefix do and the prefix su. Su is something like good. It's like sukha is happiness. Dukkha is, so do is sort of not so good. But ka is it's where, like, ancient India was always been a horse culture. Horses, wagons, chariots, and ka was where your axle went into the hub of a wheel. And so, like, sukha is when it all goes smoothly. The wheel turns freely, it's comfortable, it's pleasant. Dukkha is when it doesn't quite fit, it's tight, or it's too loose, or it's not the right shape, and it just clunk, 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 and that's dukkha. And that's how you feel that in your life. You're sort of going along, clunk, 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 and that's dukkha. The sense of getting a feeling for language, because it's how we communicate, it's how we form ideas in our own mind. We form them through language, And oftentimes we don't reflect. There's so many assumptions we make with language that they go unnoticed, not recognized. So the Buddha is trying to get us to draw attention to the, you know, what is it that contributes to a sense of discomfort, dis-ease? What contributes to a sense of ease, of comfort, of well-being? Of course, there's paths of practice, but on a very fundamental level, the sense of the assumptions that we make through our language forms how we view the world and view ourselves. So it's like one of the words we were talking about before coming down here with the organizers. It's just the word that's translated. The word from Pali is kilesa, and it's translated into English as defilement. And it's not a very satisfactory translation. It's very Christian. And then we were sort of talking and thinking, well, what would be a better translation? Well, we said, well, throwing around corruptions, no. And then you say, I don't know. Sometimes it's actually helpful to just get used to the language of Pali. Because we carry baggage with us. Because certainly the word kilesa points to some kind of stain in the mind that is kind of corrupting our experience and feeling with how we're interacting with the world and with ourselves. So that what comes to mind and of course one of the ways they've translated kilesa that they were talking is sin. Very Christian. what come to mind was a documentary that I saw years and years ago on the Thai royal family. It was done by the BBC. It was done like late 1970s, I think, maybe early 80s, but I think late 1970s. This is a 3-hour documentary, very comprehensive about the, and they had a lot of access to the whole royal family and the different duties and how they're living their lives, what they're doing. The BBC interviewer was speaking with the king, and the king, the king is a very devout Buddhist with a strong personal practice himself, and a very serious, accomplished meditator, and of course, the BBC team has been around the king and the family, and they go to monasteries. He's got his shrines. He's got his daily practice that he has himself. And the interviewer is kind of interested. What about this? What about this Buddhism? What is that? And because he's seeing that the involvement of Buddhism is very strong in his life. And then the interviewer asks, well, how does Buddhism view, how do they deal with original sin? And the king kind of has this blank look, or kind of perplexed kind of look. And he said, in Buddhism, we don't really think in terms of original sin. We think more in terms of original purity, which is, again, it's just that language. Because you think in terms of like the word defilement and original sin, those are pretty strong together. But for Buddhism, one of the things, when you're pointing to the nature of the mind, yes, there are these things called kilesas, or things that stain the mind, but they're seen as visitors. They're seen as things that come in and go out of the mind, rather than, original, solid, permanent features. And there's, of course, it's a very well-known teaching that the Buddha gives, of just pointing, the mind is luminous. It is not luminous when these visiting kilesa come and stain the mind. And so that for one who understands this, then there is the opportunity to practice. If you misunderstand this, then you take that to be something permanent or stable or integral to the mind itself. The actual nature of the mind is luminous. But of course, it gets, for lack of a better word, defiled or corrupted or stained because of these things that come in and go out of the mind. I remember one time, it's somewhat similar, with Ajahn Chah, my teacher Ajahn Chah, they were saying, if you're practicing, then you have to practice just thinking that you're you're sitting in a room and there's only one chair. And you've got to just sit in the chair and just keep that chair, because if you give up the chair, then somebody else is going to come and sit in it. He said it's like that with our mind. You've got to look after the mind, care for it, pay attention to it, recognize it for what it is, but not let the other moods and impressions and thoughts and various things that come into the mind, don't let it take over the mind. Just let them come in and let them go out. He said, in the same way, if you're sitting in the chair, yes, other people come in, they'll look around, there's nowhere to sit, they'll go out again. So it's the same thing with these different moods in the mind, the different impressions, different, there's kind of feelings that come in. Yeah, okay, they come. And when one is, aware and present, content with the luminous mind, then there's nowhere else for them to go. They leave. They go out. Something else will come in. You recognize it. Goes in, goes out. It's not... And it isn't as if... because there is this kind of idiom that gets used in Thai language, certainly, and to a certain degree in English, you've got to destroy the defilements, and calculate. Tamai? It's like there's this idiom. It's very strong. But there's a disciple of Ajahn Man Lupudun. He's passed away now. He's quite elderly. Remember him reading some Dhamma talk. He said, there's nobody who destroys the defilements, kills the defilements. All you do is know them, and they arise and they cease on their own. All you need to do is stay with the knowing. There's a simplicity to the Buddhist teachings. The capacity of the fundamental capacity of the human mind is to know. Know the objects, or know the things that we're experiencing, and to pay attention to that knowing, look after that knowing, so that it starts to stand out more, rather than letting get all jumbled up with different thoughts, feelings, impressions, obsessions that we have. But we've always got that quality of knowing that we can come back to. And you think of in terms of, like in the Thai language, when they translate the word Buddha, Puruputun Pubakba. And I expect that translation is Ajahn Buddhadāsa. Because he was very instrumental in translating, chanting, the Pali chanting into Thai so that it was both meaningful as well as kind of poetic. So some of the terms that he's used, are very common in the modern idiom these days about Buddhism. But certainly this word, just the word Buddha, the one who knows, the one who's awakened, the one who is radiant. And so that's a quality of heart. When you're speaking of the Buddha, you're not really necessarily in terms of practice, in terms of training. Of course, we have respect for the historical Buddha, but in terms of practice, what we're trying to do is to take the qualities of Buddha as a refuge for the heart. So that the refuge of returning to the knowing, letting the mind, the heart, wake up, to be awake, to be radiant, to be bright, not to let it get dull, not to let it sink into dullness and stupor. Because sometimes we'll it's easier to be dull than to have to deal with things. Yeah. We do that in all sorts of ways. But that sense of paying attention to the knowing, coming back to the knowing, brightening, awakening up, being awake, being alert, being present. When we're able to do that, then we can recognize, okay, this is the way things are. This is the experience that we're experiencing. And we don't have to get entangled in it. We don't have to allow it to stain or defile. That's something that we acquiesce to rather than something that is its true nature. The heart is in its true nature is already bright and pure and radiant. It has these visitors that we keep welcoming in, and it's like somebody comes to your house, you're where you're staying, and they knock on the door, and you open the door, and you invite them in for coffee, for something to eat, and then they don't leave. And they don't leave, because you keep giving them things to do. You keep engaging with them. And then you start complaining, when are they going to leave? And then you just keep looking after them. So our mind states are the same. Stuff comes into the mind, and I like that, I don't like that. Oh dear, I'm afraid of this one. We're bouncing around with our reactions and forgetting to come back to just this quality of knowing, of being awake, being present, being bright. Mm-hmm. So that, and it's in that knowing that things can just arise and they can cease. And then Dhamma practice becomes quite simple and straightforward. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not easy. There's a difference between easy and simple. Because we love our complications. And that's actually one of the qualities that the Buddha gives as a kind of like a prerequisite for entering into the Dhamma is to delight in non-complication. If you really start investigating your mind and paying attention, you just go, oh, look at what why do I keep doing that? The impulse to have an opinion about something. Why do I need an opinion about anything? Why do I have to judge anybody? Why do I have to judge myself? And we keep doing it. And it keeps complicating. It keeps adding a layer of proliferation and unsettledness that we keep doing this to ourselves. It's like, and that's what the Buddha is saying, when he says dukkha or suffering or unsatisfactoriness, it's not from stuff outside. Yes, there are situations where there is difficulty or you have some loss. Yes, now that happens. But it can be seen, it can be understood, it can be dealt with skillfully. It can be dealt with wisdom. But the actual suffering and discontent and difficulty is our own resistance, aversion, fear, or desire for something else that keeps the mind off balance, keeps the mind from experiencing or being able to be content with being the one who knows, being awake, being bright and radiant. It's this compulsion just being able to see that is really important, to be able to recognize that. And then also to just not respond to it with coming up with an idealization of how we should be and then torture ourselves with that. I should be more peaceful. We should all be more peaceful, but it's like that kind of mandate that we push on ourselves leaves us dissatisfied, not very happy. So that it's learning how to encourage oneself with the possibility of living within a path of practice and training. that cultivation of virtue and integrity. In Buddhism, you have fundamental precepts that form the basis of your life, and those are really important to be paying attention to, but they're not sort of mandates. They are it's like a mirror to help us recognize how to what is complicating our life. It's like with precepts, and you're committed to non-harming, not taking the life of any living creature, let's say not killing, not stealing, maintaining an integrity in one's relationships, family relationships, sexual relationships, one's commitment to speech that is not deceiving, not harsh, and then from refraining from intoxicants, things that dull the mind, so that and one of the reasons for those precepts is more like helping to protect oneself from the results of those kind of actions, because it just, when we engage in something that is dishonest or it has an effect in our relationships with people. Trust, like one of the things that, like, there's a teaching that the Buddha gave where he talked about, say, the five great gifts, the five great gifts and usually when you think of gifts and giving, then dana, mahatan, usually you're thinking of, making some kind of monetary or physical donation. But the Buddha said the five great gifts are basically the five precepts. He said, refraining from killing, refraining from stealing. And he said, they are the five great gifts because they give the gift of safety, security, trust with our fellow human beings. We build relationships of trust and empathy with each other when we are committed to those precepts. So it's like it's a gift to others, it's a gift to oneself. So that it's not so much, you got to keep those precepts, but it's more like, when I keep those precepts, then things start to go a lot more smoothly. Relationships, whether family or working relationships, social relationships, those start to go more smoothly, because as human beings, we are in relationship with other human beings all the time anyway. And to pay attention to the relationships that are grounded in trust and empathy, those are very strong bonds that are really supportive for our life, how we live our life, and how the kind of happiness that we experience. As it's there's one of the things that the Buddha points to as a essential piece of growth in the Dhamma, growth in training, growth in this way of practice toward freedom from suffering, is having kalyanamitta, good spiritual friendships. And so, good spiritual friendships are friendships or associations with people who you feel you can trust, people who you feel are empathetic to you as another human being, so that So these are, again, this sense of, oh, the great, the gifts that we give to ourselves, give to others, are around our, beginning with our actions and speech. And of course, then it starts to set a template for cultivation of loving kindness, compassion, and being able to, dwell with a certain kindness and generosity. And it's a real sense of happiness that comes from that. And so that there's, it's reflecting on the Buddha's path and just his teaching. And again, reflecting on language, how it affects us, assumptions we make with it. But also reflecting on how that sense of not being, say, caught by language either, because I mean we do, we formulate ideas and opinions. It has to have some structure to it, and the structure is usually language. I mean, but to realize what it's actually pointing to, because it's always language should always be pointing to experience. So paying attention to experience, and of course, one of the most important bases of experience is experience of dukkha, because nobody wants to feel uncomfortable or dissatisfied or discontent. Everybody wants to feel happy and peaceful. There, and it's one of the questions that would come up over and over again, still comes up. My teacher, Ajahn Chah, had many, many Western disciples. And people would always ask, because he was, from a worldly sense, he was quite uneducated. From the northeast of Thailand, from a village family, village background, farming, just a farming village. And, how did he end up with all these Western disciples? How did he communicate with you? How did he teach you? What language did he use? And Ajahn Chah, I remember one time being asked, but he's answered in a few different ways. But one of the ways that he said it's like having a cup of warm water like this. If you've got a cup of warm water, of course, if you're Thai, then you wouldn't say warm water, you'd say Nam Lohan. And so like for Ajahn Chah, it's okay. But he wouldn't even use Nam Lohan because he usually didn't speak Thai. He spoke a Isan dialect, say Nam Hon. And then, of course, English is hot water, and French is another word, and German's another word, and just Chinese is another word. So using language kind of gets confusing what it is. If you try to figure it out through language, it's the only way you can figure it out is just pick it up and have a sip. Then you'll know what hot water is or Nam Lohan is. It's just because it, and he said, Dhamma is like that. Dhamma is not about the words or the language, it's about the experience. So the point of Dhamma is to turn us to our experience. And again, coming back to that, dukkha, cessation of dukkha, suffering, cessation of suffering. The experience of stress, cessation of stress. So those are to be able to recognize it and recognize that there is a way out. There's a way of living, there's a way of practicing, there's a way of training that can free the heart from all forms of dukkha. So those are some reflection for the evening. I wanted to leave time for questions. If anybody has any questions, you're welcome to ask.
How do you become not entangled but still, do you want louder? How do you become not entangled but still loving and caring?
Well, part of it is recognizing looking at the feeling of discontent, dis-ease that comes up. Because when we get intense, it's like being loving and caring is one thing, but being loving and caring and then expecting people to conform to your wishes of how you would like them to be because you love them and care for them, that's entanglement. It's one thing. Yeah, we have love and care for somebody else, but then oftentimes we want them to be the way that we prefer, and yeah, so that's an entanglement that ends up with dukkha, with suffering. So learning how to recognize that impulse, and so it's just coming, pulling back from that habit or that tendency or that expectation of somebody pleasing you. And that's a problem. So you can be loving and caring, but there's going to be times when they reciprocate and times when they don't. So that you have to let it understand, okay, this is, we've got to give some space to this.
Any more questions?
Thank you, Pajan, for sharing Dhamma today. My question is, when we are in the difficult situation or when we are suffering, what should we focus on?
When we have deep concentration.
When we are in the difficult situation. Or when we are suffering, okay. What should we focus on?
Well, I mean, sometimes, especially when you're in a difficult situation, sometimes it can be very agitating or confusing. So sometimes, when you're in something that's quite difficult, then finding an anchor that helps one to settle a bit is really important. So sometimes you're in a difficult situation, it could be kind of overwhelming or upsetting, or one of the things that I've always used and found helpful for me, coming back to the body, like physical body, we tend to tighten up. If we're in a difficult situation or we're feeling threatened or nervous in some way, then we tend to tighten up, we tend to close in, and then the sense of the mind tends to spin out more. So coming back to something tangible and then learning how to relax with that, then you've got an anchor that is reasonably solid that you can then relax into. And then the mind and the emotions start to settle down so that you've got some clarity. Okay, what's actually happening here? What's a good way to go forward? But you need a bit of clarity in order to recognize what's going to be useful. So oftentimes, I mean, I've always found like returning to the body and mindfulness of the body, relaxing into the body, using the body as a vehicle for helping to settle and relax is important. Because if you go straight to the mind, it's already spinning. And you're really at a disadvantage.
Thanks for the good tip, Ajahn. I feel it's very useful for me too. It's great. Any more questions? Sorry.
Namaskar, Pa Ajahn. I'm actually from America.
Oh, okay.
Yes. I grew up in America, but I have a background. I was born in Isan, but my Thai is not so good. So today I came not knowing who you are, but I'm actually doing some translation for a book from somebody who gave me this assignment. It is for translating Thai to English, but my Thai is not so good. And today I came thinking maybe there was a calling or something. So what I learned today from you was helpful.
Okay. Yeah.
And I guess I'm supposed to be here today as well. So thank you.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, that's like with learning language, sometimes like translating and reading, that's how you build up vocabulary and understanding the structure of the language. So even if you never ever get a real translation, it'll be a great exercise for learning. I mean, I played a lot with, well, reading, that's how I learned the language. Because when I came to live in Thailand, there was hardly any resources for learning Thai. Basically, there was one book, and it didn't take long to read that and get my notes down. But it gave me basic structure, and of course I'm out living out in the countryside, so. Just reading, listening, and then building up a vocabulary and learning how, and also you just have to keep using it. And it's how one learns. Sometimes just putting yourself in a situation where you have to do it. You jump in the deep end and you'll learn.
That is very good. And may I ask the opportunity from Phra Ajahn that, like, Phra Ajahn speak great, good Thai, actually. And then, yeah, so if you don't feel like asking in English, asking in Thai also okay. His Thai is very, very good. And his Dhamma speaking in Thai is also very good.
It was funny. One time, because I lived in Thailand for altogether like 23 years before going to America. And I lived here for 16 years before going back. I grew up in Canada. So I lived for about 16 years before going back to visit my family for the first time. And so living in Thailand, and then especially being an abbot of a monastery, then you're in pretty constant contact with the villagers or people coming to listen to Dhamma or people from Bangkok or wherever from the city. So you're engaging with people. So my language was quite good. Then after 16 years, I went back to visit family, and it was an extended trip where I did some teaching, visited with family. I led a retreat which my sister, my mother, my father all joined. And then I gave a couple Dhamma talks in different places in English. Then toward the end of the trip with my parents, and we went to visit one of my brothers who was living in Toronto. That was the last place we were going to. And then got invited to go to a home of a Thai family for a meal offering. And so then I was talking to the Thai people who were there and chatting and then visiting with them. And they were in the, and my parents were there, and they were in the car going back to my brothers. And my mom said, "That was really interesting to see you. You're actually more comfortable in Thai than you are in English." Because also I'd never really talked anything about Dhamma in English very much. Most of it, learning Buddhism, Dhamma, and meditation and Dhamma language was mostly with Thai. Really having to look for words in English to express myself. But living in America now for 20 years, and I've got my English is better, my Thai has gone back.
Thank you, Phra Ajahn, for a very useful and interesting Dhamma talk. My question is, to me personally, I think it's easy to control ourselves, not control, like to be aware by ourselves when we come to experience like unpleasant experience, because it's just within ourselves. But in the situation such as at work, it's not just us anymore. We have to interact with others and we have to accomplish something like a task, and we cannot fail that. Say, how do we cope with such situation when we have bosses' expectation, when we have all those difficulties? It's like it's easy for us to like, oh, let it go. Just, we can accept that. But there are so many people who cannot accept failures and their pressure at work. So how do we deal with those things at work?
Well, one is just to be able to recognize what the pressures are, because oftentimes a lot of the pressures are, obviously we have to get something accomplished and we have to do it well, but we oftentimes add layers of more expectation or more assumption and more worry about what people think of us. So that there's these different layers of complication that we add. So to be able to recognize that, and then see, well, what are we? Because things like that we can start to let go of. There's aspects that we have to work with other people. Then that takes another kind of skill. I mean, you can't just let go of that and oh, whatever. But you do have to figure out, because different people are motivated in different ways, and some people you can say something like that is quite, maybe quite blunt or quite like, we got to get this done, and then there's an understanding, or it gets some urgency going. Other people, they just shut down because of that. So then you've got to figure, okay, that person, that we've got to draw them in and collaborate with them. We've got to work with them. We've got to encourage them, or we have to be you know, somehow we have to communicate together to make. So there's that takes some discernment and reflection. You just can't come from a template of, say, some ideal or some assumption, because you've got to figure it out all along the way, but it does mean that we have to reflect and investigate. Well, what's going to work in this case? What's not going to work in this case? And some things you do try, and it really doesn't work, and you've got to be ready to just drop that and adapt and try something else. So you have to be a bit innovative in being able to figure out how are we going to get this done? How are we going to make this work? How are we going to actually work together? So it takes some experimenting, and in experimenting, sometimes you're going to fail. And it's not the end of the world. Or you might upset somebody because you've pushed a bit too hard, or you've done. So you have to be ready to also to apologize or ask for forgiveness, and not hold oneself too tightly or elevate oneself too much.
Any more questions?
Namaskar, Ajahn Chah. I know that people practice is from the suffering. Yeah? We realize that we're suffering, and then we try to get rid of suffering by follow the Buddha teaching, and then we get happiness. And how can we handle with the happiness? Because in the teaching, it's not good or not bad. So people try to cling to the happiness, to the body, to the self. So I think it's more difficult than we get rid of suffering when we happiness like this.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things is starting to reflect and investigate on, because happiness is, I mean, like in the teachings, there's a certain. I mean, the Buddha uses the use of language. Suffering, end of suffering, but. In terms of, because there's a certain clarity there, but then once you start reflecting and extrapolating, then you start realizing, oh well, in reality, we really have to pay attention to how do we create happiness? How do we create well-being? What's the foundation of a happiness that isn't complicated, and that's what the. So it was one of the insights of the Buddha himself before his awakening, is that of course he was committed to kind of a gung-ho asceticism, and he wasn't getting enlightened, and he wasn't very happy either, I'm sure, but. And then he reflected on the time when he was still a young boy, and his mind became very peaceful and happy. And he reflected, that happiness, that is, because that was like an untainted happiness, like an uncomplicated happiness. He said, that happiness that isn't based on clinging or attachment or complication, maybe that's the way. And then he thought, that happiness is the way. So it's just the happiness is really important to be cultivating. But it's the happiness that's built on goodness, on integrity, on really wholesome qualities. Like generosity, kindness, a sense of sharing and service, as well as being able to learn how to settle and bring the mind, the heart to a place of stillness and clarity. All of these are sources of happiness, but they're not a happiness that is normally what we associate happiness with is getting what we want, okay? In some way. But this is it's based on something different. It's not based on a gratification of our preferences or our desires. It's based on establishing the heart in this integrity, skillfulness, qualities that are really solid and kind of selfless. So then there's an expansiveness to the heart. There's a happiness there that's very bright. So we have to learn how to cultivate that.
The lady at the back.
Namaskar, Ajahn Chah. According to your experience, that you come to stay in Thailand and 16 years, and then you go back to your home. I would like to ask that, do you have any advice for to adjust in the different environment when you go back to home? For example, in perspective and behavior with your family. Thank you.
Well, going back to a family, I think one of the things that always, because of, like in our community, our monks always go, from time to time at least, go back to visit family, and it's important to do that, maintain that connection with family. And in the English, we use an idiom like people push your buttons. But with parents and family, it isn't that they push your buttons, they put the buttons there. so you have to recognize that when you go back, it's really interesting. Say like for myself, I mean, I was away from family for a long time, by the time I went back, I was like 40 or something. But then you still feel yourself in time sort of reverting to this sort of relationship with family where you're still a child. And you think, oh no, I mean... But a lot of it is just really making it conscious. Because oftentimes what happens is we have a reaction like that, and then we either sort of slip into it and then feel uncomfortable or kind of feel guilty or stupid because we did. Or we get averse and kind of uptight about it. But it's more like, no, these are... We are conditioned beings, and learning how to recognize how conditioning takes place as a human being, what's there, and have some kindness around it. Have some that kind of awareness and compassion for yourself and for your family, so you just don't keep repeating patterns that just aren't so useful.
Thank you very much. This is very interesting word, conditioned being. I never think about it that way. But it's good thought word. Okay, one more question.
Grab namaskar. I have a problem about judge the other people. How can I get away from this situation?
Judging other people.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Okay.
Thank you.
Well, I mean, you got a choice. You can keep suffering or you can quit. Really pay attention to the results of it. What it feels like. And that's so much, again, Ajahn Chah's encouragement. This is about experience. It's not about some ideal that you set up for yourself. Oh, I should never judge other people. So, no, you recognize that habit or that movement or that impulse. Pay attention to how it feels. Pay attention to the result it has. Because it'd be uncomfortable. It's not the most beautiful mind state that you've ever had. This needs to be worked on. It needs to be relinquished, or it needs to be, tone it down a bit. Yeah.
One question from, please.
Namaskar, Ajahn. So as I'm a lay person who goes to work and has a family, I just wonder, what do I have to do to get to attend Sodaban? And if the wanting of attending Sodaban is okay, because it's a wanting.
Well, I mean, but if you're going to want something, you may as well want something that's good for yourself. And actually, I mean, this is another aspect of the Buddha's teaching. The Buddha points to desire or wanting as a source of suffering. Like in the Four Noble Truths, there's suffering, there's the cause of suffering. The cause of suffering is desire, different forms of desire. The word is tanha. So, again, you're speaking language. So it's in the language itself, it is desire that is accompanied or entangled with greed, hatred, delusion, different types of defilement. And it always ends up in suffering. Whereas there's teachings that the Buddha gave that are, like, there's one set of teachings in particular that the Buddha gave that are called the four bases of spiritual success. So, like, if one is thinking, oh, I want to accomplish or realize something in this practice, in this Dhamma practice, and so there's four conditions. The first condition is chanda, which is desire. This is your normal translation is desire. So, okay, here you're looking, desire here is the cause of suffering. Desire here is a basis of spiritual success. Well, it's true, you need, because it's desire in the sense that one has to have desire in the sense of, like, interest, motivation. Because without that kind of interest or motivation, you don't do anything. And the next factor in that teaching is effort or putting forth energy. So it's without some kind of desire, some wanting, some motivation, some interest, then we don't have the energy to and willingness to put forth effort to do it. So a wanting for sotapanna, for stream entry, dhamma chanda, the desire for dhamma, or kusala chanda, desire for the wholesome, desire for the good. Those are, it can be skillful and necessary. But I think also one of the things in conceiving of stream entry, I think it's important to recognize, we can make it into something that's so elevated that it's like unrealizable, you know, like just out of the reach of our ordinary ability to realize. But if you go to the suttas, the discourses that the Buddha gives, and over again, the description that the Buddha gives of the characteristics of a sotapanna, of a stream enterer, four qualities come up over and over and over again. Confirmed confidence or faith in the Buddha, confidence, faith in the Dhamma, confidence, faith in the Sangha, and a commitment to the sila, integrity and virtue that is stable, solid. And that's the overwhelming description, and that's not beyond anybody's reach. Also the qualities that are pointed to as necessary for cultivation, for entering the stream, I'm trying to remember the. One is this. I'm blanking right now. It's what happens when you get older. There. But the sense of association with people who are practicing Dhamma, hearing the Dhamma. So those are external qualities. Then there's the internal qualities of investigate yoniso manasikara, wise attention, appropriate attention, and then the last one. Dhamma nu dhamma pativipata, practicing Dhamma in accordance with Dhamma. So that those are qualities that are, that's not beyond the capacity of anybody. So that setting an intention or setting an aspiration for entering the stream is really skillful, really appropriate. Say, as a Buddhist, yeah, go for it.
We have shortened time, so one or two last questions. Anyone want to ask?
I would like to ask a question about the topic of letting go. Uh-huh. So during my time in Thailand, I learned that the first step to let go is to let go on anger. Mm-hmm. And this is not that hard. I'm sure that all people in this room are able to do that. But I would like to ask, how can we let go on suffering, especially when we have a lot of pain inside, maybe because of we lose someone we love? Mm-hmm. How can we learn to let go on this and live with this suffering?
I think one of the ways is looking at it in terms of not so much letting go of the suffering, how do we transform it? How do we take suffering and turn it into compassion? So that's a really, because oftentimes we think, oh, there's this suffering and this sense of loss that we have, or this sense of difficulty that we have experienced in our life that we identify with. So rather than, because as soon as we start saying, oh, I've got to let go of it, like I shouldn't have this. But I think a more useful way is to take it, how do I transform that into something that informs my wisdom, informs my compassion, informs my empathy and generosity with myself and with others. Then there's a letting go that happens that is quite organic. It's still a letting go, but it's not, because oftentimes when we say, oh, I should let go, it's usually an ideal. And we have an ideal that we feel we should conform to. But by turning it, it's like, and thinking in terms of transformation, then we realize we can take that as a, that difficulty, that suffering, that loss, and we can turn it into something that gives us a strength that is to our benefit and the benefit of others.
Any more questions? I like this a lot when you said about transform to compassion. This is very good, and I will follow to do that too. Okay, one question.
Okay. Concerning about the confidence in the Dhamma, I always have some doubtful. What kind of Dhamma that I should be confident on? Is that the actual Dhamma from the Buddha, or it's because there are a lot of them, and people always talk Dhamma. And which one should I follow, or which one should I just don't pay attention in?
Okay.
Thank you.
Come back to the, say, the Dhamma that the Buddha taught, is that, how do you decide if something conforms with Dhamma? How do you know if you're progressing in the Dhamma? And what the Buddha said is that you can recognize it when that which is, and the word, there's technical terms, kusala and akusala. These are qualities of mind. Kusala is around the qualities of mind that are wholesome, skillful, beneficial, tending to be associated with happiness, well-being, peace, clarity. And of course, akusala is its opposite, unwholesome, unskillful, confused, all of that. But so one recognizes there is some growth or something conforms with Dhamma when the kusala qualities are kusala increase and the akusala decrease. So we can be paying attention to that, recognizing how to support those qualities that are wholesome, skillful, or recognizing when those are, and the akusala are decreasing or falling away. Then you see, okay, that conforms with Dhamma. Back to experience.